those of us who were his closest friends. He said to me one day, he said, the imperfection of this world is that after all the knowledge, experience, and perfections that we attain as humans, like Albert Einstein, Amadeus Mozart, Muhammad Ali, it must all go to waste because a man must die. I have since his death, on a few occasions in my quiet moments, wonder how my brother and comrade confronted death in his final moments.
Holy Father in heaven, praise be to you for all your wonders, your faithfulness too in the assembly of the holy ones. You are the God who stopped the sun for Joshua. You are the God who closed the mouth of hungry lions for Daniel. You are the God who parted the Red Sea for the children of Israel. You are the God who is able to act with supernatural power in our lives. You are Jehovah Jireh, the Lord our provider. You are El Shaddai, the God who is more than enough.
Daddy, I miss your voice, and especially how you would call me daughter. My heart is wrenched, my stomach is in knots. Sleepless nights and then dreaming of you when I sleep, only to wake up to the cruel and painful reality of never seeing you again. I loved your passion for living and admired how you successfully maneuvered life despite difficulties.
He loved to share testimonies of particular blessings of what God had done for him. We would have deep discussions about God and the Bible. Sometimes he would take my ideas and encourage me to teach, write, and to share them with others. He would insist, Nana, this is what God wants you to do.
We lost our brother, husband, father, uncle, and a friend, Kwesi Senti Bafoboni, affectionately known as Babo. Our minds are flooded with memories, and it's hard to find words to describe him. We are all heartbroken, but we are here today not only to mourn his passing, but to celebrate the life of my brother.
For the fact is, those who believe in the Lord Jesus Christ leave this earth to gain something better. We leave this mortal body, which is perishable. We leave this mortal body, which is subject to sickness and pain and disease. We leave this temporary life with all its suffering and struggles, and we gain an eternal joy. We gain bodies that will never perish. We gain a reward that will never be taken from us. We gain a place where there is nothing but peace and joy and happiness.
Once again, I want to cordially welcome you to this program. The filing pass has ended, and we are going to continue with the pre-service tributes. And there's tributes to be read in this order. First, from Radio Gold, to be read by Mr. B.B. Manson. Brothers and sisters from Mabel Bafoboni. Nieces and nephews, Peter Bafoboni Jr. And then finally, from the National Democratic Congress, read by Obobia Dakwa Opoku. So we invite first Mr. B.B. Manson from Radio Gold to come and read the tribute.
Tribute from the management and staff of Network Broadcasting Company Limited, Radio Gold 90.5 FM. Mr. Kwesi Senti Bafoboni, GM, as in general manager, or Babo, as many of us workers of Radio Gold used to call him, was not just our employer. He was a father, a friend, a mentor to many of his members of staff at Radio Gold, many of whom were first-timers at the job. He devoted his time and energy to building and promoting Radio Gold. He was deeply passionate about Radio Gold, and he gave a lot of his time to making sure that the station carved a niche for itself right from its beginning. He believed that radio must be used to inform, educate, and entertain. In addition, Babu also ensured that beyond covering mainstream issues, a substantial amount of airtime was devoted to issues of women and children, the marginalized, the poor, and less powerful, to give them a voice. In many ways, Mr. Bafoboni was the ideal leader our station needed at the time that he was in charge. He was everything that the general manager of a radio station needed to run a successful radio station. He said what he had to say to us, managed what he needed to manage, and always strived to make us excel on air. He was a foundation of radio content and creative ideas. He was also bubbling with new ideas, and he shared these with us, his team of broadcasters. He was open-minded, and we would therefore subject many of his ideas and suggestions to scrutiny. Most of the time, though, his ideas were productive. Point of correction, all the time, his ideas were productive. Mr. Bafoboni had a knack for spotting, supporting, and developing fresh and young talent. The list of his discovery of broadcasting talent and encouraging them to succeed by nurturing and developing their career to become household names is endless. Perhaps no one person since the advent of private radio in Ghana has identified and groomed as many broadcasting talents as he did. He will forever, for a very long time, remain iconic, a figure in the history of Ghana's private radio industry. At one point, and for a very long time, there was hardly a radio station in this country that did not have at least one person who had been trained by his beloved radio station. Radio Gold, that it is, your power station. Mr. Bafoboni's footprints in the annals of Ghana's private radio industry is permanently engraved in gold and is in the hearts of Radio Gold's employees and its listeners. The radio industry has lost one of the strongest pillars, and the industry would be poorer without him. Now on the personal note, I have known Mr. Bafoboni for over 20 years. He was my general manager for 15 years until he handed over to me, then to work for the Vice President, His Excellency John Dramani Mahama. We affectionately called him Babu or GM, not only at the workplace, but whenever we met him outside. My past colleagues will agree with me that he was affable, compassionate, peaceful, kind, and helpful. Those qualities came easily to him. We felt comfortable, equal, and had a good relationship with him. And he had confidence in us. We were always ready to go an extra mile when he called, especially in times of emergency at our workplace. He was hands-on and loved to get things done, even if it took him after work hours to do it. He knew he could call on us anytime to address issues at work. Babu, GM, would go an extra mile to assist staff, or call many friends or brothers to do the same to ensure that the member of staff was comfortable. He loved to discuss politics. Above all, he believed in fairness. Whenever he entered the office, he would smile broadly and ask, "How are you?" He loved music and would encourage Radio Gold presenters to play what he called hits after hits after hits after hits after hits. I added that. He brought joy to us and others. He loved to share jokes and stories. After he left to work in government, he continued to remain active and would help us when we needed him. Although those days are gone, they are not forgotten. It is really hard to accept his sudden death and will never be accustomed to it. Gone before us too soon, Babo, GM, boss, Bafo Money. Certainly, the precious moments and memories of you will remain in our hearts. In everything, all we can say is that God gives and takes. He is a wise God. To the Bafo Bunny family, all I can say is that be consoled in the knowledge that he is resting safely with the Creator. Babu Demri Fadwe.
Thank you, Mr. Bibi Manson, for that powerful tribute. So we take the tribute from the brothers and sisters, and we are calling on Mabel Bafo Bunny to come and read the tribute. She'll be followed by Peter Bafo Bunny Jr.
Tribute from brothers and sisters. The heavenly gate of heaven, kingdom has been inexplicably opened to you. And you wish that your soul has found its perfect place of rest. From your brothers and sisters, undeniably, your sudden death on 1st February 2021 has so got some family members and friends in a state of shock. Yes, inarguably, we understand death to be the final phase of our earthly dwelling. Distressingly, it is a phase which is not equipped with any sophisticated advanced warning system designed with a predetermined schedule of who is next in the line to join our Creator. And that's why, in the midst of our expression of shock, we ask the question, why so soon? As Christians, searching for the meaning of death, rely on the comforting words of the psalmist, chapter 30, verse 5. Weeping may remain for a night, but rejoicing comes in the morning. We are weeping today because of your demise, but we are comforted because we will rejoice one day when we all meet our Maker in heaven. The countless memories we can recall include your return from secondary school to teach the Form 3 class, how you and your lovely wife, Nana, warmly receive us on the campus of Ohio University at Athens, Ohio, on our first visit to the United States of America. Your facilitation for some of us to travel to the United States. You are resettling in Ghana from the USA, which paved the way for some of us to make our own transition to Ghana easier. In one way or the other, your various acts of kindness and generosity impacted our lives. Indeed, you were always our spiritual agitator, driven by your exquisite yearning for the excellence. You have indiscriminately applied this principle to all your brothers and sisters in all our endeavors. Without any hesitation, you always served as a mentor, a friend, and a role model, especially to the younger ones. We always look up to you as a brother who truly cared for the realization of our goals, aspirations, and ambition by providing for us with a navigational guidance system designed to deal with life's complexities. Your philosophical definition of what is a decent family ought to be in terms of expression of love towards each other and respect for divergent views was highly commendable. The endearing respect that you always accorded our immediate family, our wives, husbands, and children, will forever remain in our memories till we meet again in a perfect peace and a lasting joy. The heavenly gate of heaven has been inexplicably opened to you, and we wish that your soul has found its perfect place of rest. Kwesi, our brother, our mentor, our friends, may your soul rest perfectly with the Lord. And we are saying them refer to you from your brothers in Kumasi, Accra, Sashi Bekwai, Cape Coast, and other family members of and chief mourners. And Sashi Bekwai. But that we say them refer for the love, for the attention, for the family, and for everybody you came across. In the name of Jesus, I say amen.
Seize this opportunity to welcome Nana Ajimambedu, King of the Domain Crew, to this ceremony. Nana, you are warmly welcome. Amen. So we'll continue with our tributes, and next is Peter Bafuboni Jr. to read the tribute on behalf of the nieces and nephews. Thank you.
Tribute from nieces and nephews. Uncle, you never said you were leaving. You were gone before we knew. A million times we have needed you. A million times we have cried. If love alone could have saved you, you never would have died. In life, we loved you dearly. In death, we love you still. In our hearts, we have needed you. A million times we have cried. If love alone could have saved you, in our hearts, we hold a place no one else will ever fill. It broke our hearts to lose you. However, you didn't go alone. Part of us went with you the day God took you home. Some people forget that nieces and nephews grieve too. We will not stand on your grave and weep. You are not there. You are in the thousand winds that blow. We think of you every day, but that is nothing new. We think about you today and the days before. We think about you in silence and often your name. All we have are memories and your picture in a frame. Your memory is our keepsake with which we will never part. God has you in his keeping. We have you in our hearts. Our hearts are broken and constant tears flow. Death, it seems you have won. You don't really need our uncle, do you? Uncle, we heard your voice in the wind today. You may have died, but you are not gone. You will always be a part of us. Our uncle, the saint, was the best. Better than all of them. Better than anyone will ever know. To call it, he was a very special offer who had cared and loved us all dearly, and with right too. Our dear offer had individual love and affection for each and every one of us. We really loved him and still do. Please don't tell us that time will heal our pain, because not even time will bring our delightful and most loved uncle back again. The Lord reached right down, took our uncle's hand, and led him into the skies on the 1st February 2021. Bravo, uncle, our special saint. May the wings of God's angel wrap you in love. Be happy, because you will never be replaced or forgotten. A protector never dies. And that is what you were and are still to us. The saint, the special one, we will love you to the moon and back. What a trendy uncle anyone could ever wish for. We were extremely lucky to have the kind of beautiful bond we shared with you. No one can come close to that special kind of love you showered on us. We will not even allow. Rest peacefully in God's strong hands. Demi Fredwe.
I would like to appropriately and acknowledge the king in our midst. He is Osajifo Osiadieyo Ajiman Bedu II of Doma Hinkro, the president of the House of Chiefs of the Bono region. Nana, once again, we acknowledge your presence and we say welcome. Thank you. A few months ago, I was called to go and pray for a member of the church. And I went to Leicester Hospital and I sat by this man that we are celebrating this morning. That was my first meeting with him. But his calm composure, his peaceful nature, and the way he presented himself to me was as if we have met several times before. And this is the man we are celebrating this morning. And as we mourn, we must know one thing, that the people we love so much, God also loves them more than us. And at the right time, when he needs them, he calls them. And we are thankful to God that at the right time, he called our brother, our father, our uncle. And no matter how you relate to him, we believe he was a good man. The next tribute to be read will be coming from the National Democratic Congress and to be read by Obobia Dankwa Opoku.
Tribute by the National Democratic Congress. On 1st February 2021, the National Democratic Congress was shaken by the unexpected death of a senior comrade, Kwesi Seinti Bafuboni, widely known as Babu. Comrade Bafuboni was a close confidant of President John Dramani Mahama, and his death has robbed our illustrious leader of the companionship and advice of this pillar of the party. Comrade Bafuboni was a member of the campaign team of the then NDC vice presidential candidate, John Dramani Mahama, in 2008, and went everywhere in Ghana where the campaign took the team. He was a quiet, reliable, approachable, and solid team member from whom many of the younger members of the party imbibed lessons of always remaining calm, cool, and collected, even in the face of the most difficult and provocative circumstances. When Vice President John Dramani Mahama assumed the presidency after the unfortunate demise of the much-beloved Professor John Evans Atta Mills in July 2012, Comrade Bafoboni rose to become a senior presidential advisor and held that position until 2016, when the NDC lost power. Most importantly, our fallen comrade will be remembered for his managerial skills in running Radio Gold in the mid-1990s to provide the people of Ghana with a structured, decent, and effective vehicle through which the NDC carried its message to Ghanaians. Through him and his hard work, Radio Gold became an enduring institution of information, entertainment, and education. To our fallen comrade's credit goes the honor of nurturing numerous Radio Gold personalities who started their pupilage at Radio Gold and are now ruling the airwaves with confidence and poise. We in the NDC, on the occasion of the funeral of our comrade, pledged to do everything possible to resurrect the Radio Gold, the radio station, as soon as possible, so as to immortalize him in the pantheon of the fallen heroes of the social democratic enterprise in Ghana. To his family and friends, we say Demrifa Di. To President Mahama, we say take heart. The God who gave you Comrade Babu will comfort and soothe your pain. Rest in peace, comrade. Thank you very much.
Thank you, my sister, for that wonderful tribute. It is time for the part two of the filing past. And as led by the, or directed by the ushers, if you haven't done that, maybe you came earlier, later on. This is the time for us to move in that direction. So the ushers will direct you, those who have not done the filing pass yet, for the next few minutes, for the filing pass to be done. After that, the ministers present will gather around the casket, will pray, and then the casket will be closed. Thank you.
Still our ancient foe does
Once again, you are all welcome. And at this point, I will invite the clergy to file past, whilst after which the casket will be closed. The clergy will be led by the father of the house, Reverend Dr. R.C. Whitcomb. And if you are part of the clergy invited here, you are also invited to join in the fire past. Thank you. We bless you and we thank you for a wonderful life lived. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We'll call on the pallbearers to come over and then help in the closing of the casket. Thank you. service, the burial service will start very soon in the next 1 minute. Thank you.
We'll be taking our first hymn of the service, In Heavenly Love Abiding.
Dearly beloved, we are gathered together here today in the presence of God Almighty and this great crowd of witnesses to say our final farewell to our beloved father, brother, uncle, and friend, Kwesi Sainty Bafobani. We come together today in the shadow of sorrow and grief. And yet, even as we mourn, we also celebrate. We celebrate a life well lived. We celebrate fond memories of time spent together. We celebrate his life and remember his warmth, his love, his courage, his strength. And most of all, we celebrate the great hope, the greatest hope known to man, the hope of the resurrection, the hope of eternal life given to us through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Therefore, now let us turn to that Savior. Let us seek that hope. Let us go to God in prayer and commit our ways and this service to him. Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting Father, we come before you in this hour of grief and sorrow and mourning, when the darkness of night seems to have engulfed our soul. But we know, God, that there is a greater reality than what we see and what we feel. There is the reality of your presence, of your peace, and of your promise. And so to that we turn today, to that we cling today, when all else has failed, when there is no human remedy, no human hope, no strength to go on, we turn to you, our Father, who art in heaven. And we come to you with a promise that you've given to us, that all who come in faith will receive, all who seek you will find, and all who follow you will rejoice in eternal life. And in that we feel the tide turn, in that moment of glorious joy when we look into your face above and see that this is not the end, but there is eternity ahead. There is the great joy of reunion with you and loved ones in the future awaiting us. There is the prize of our call. In that moment, as we turn to you, we feel the light shine, the hope rise, the strength infuse us, and we thank you. Be with each and every one of us today, most especially the family, those closest to him. Be with each of us as we celebrate his life and remember with fondness our time spent together. Be with us as we reflect on the meaning of all that is said and done today. Be with us, Lord, that we might take away from here not just an experience, not just a memory, but a hope in our heart that will be for us as well, the hope of eternal life. We commit this funeral service into your hands now. We ask for your blessing in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen.
Is
Thank you, Heart Song. We want to acknowledge the presence of some dignitaries, important dignitaries in our midst this morning. And I want to start with President John Dramani Mahama, former President of the Republic of Ghana. Welcome, Sir President. Former First Lady Lordina Mahama, she's also here with us. Former Chief of Staff Julius Debra. Professor Nana Jane Opoku Ajimai, former Minister of Education and NDC 2020 running mate. Honorable Samuel Ofosu Ampofo, NDC National Chairman. Honorable Kwesi Ahoy, former Minister of Agriculture. Honorable Joyce Bawa Mukhtari, special aide to President John Mahama. And they are the members of Parliament. We acknowledge your presence here. Yao Jan, former national organizer of the NDC. John Abdullahi Jinapo, former deputy minister of power. Dr. Edward Omane Buama, former minister for communications. Emilia Arthur, former presidential staffer. Stan Dugbe, special assistant to the former president John Mahama. Madam Faustina Nelson, senior member of the NDC. I want to welcome some chiefs here and Queen Mothers. Nana Echia Kwame II of Kantakrubo, if I'm correct, just pardon me. Nana Ejipoma, Queen Mother of Sefi Bekwai. Justice Paul Bafuboni. Professor Ben Bafuboni, Professor Edu Jemfi, Chrissy Pratt, and KSM, Kweku Sintimisa. Mr. Ivor Greenstreet, former flag bearer of the CPP, and then the last but not the least, Nanaya Champim, Jemfua, if I'm correct, General Secretary for the CPP. Ladies and gentlemen, you are all welcome and all protocol is observed. Thank you. At this point, we are going to take the scripture reading. If you are taking the scripture reading, please come sit by my right here on the seat here. The first scripture reading will be taken from 1 Thessalonians chapter 1 from verse 13 to 18. It will be read by Kwabna Edu Jemfi, and the second one will be taken from 1 Corinthians chapter 15 from verse 50 to 58. It will be read by Reverend Grisa Bonzi. So I would like to invite Kwabna Edu Jemfi to take us through the first Bible reading. Please take the pulpit on the side.
Our first scripture reading is from 1 Thessalonians 4:13-18. In your brochures is written 1 Thessalonians 1:13-18. Please kindly do the correction. Brothers and sisters, we do not want you to be uninformed about those who sleep in death, so that you do not grieve like the rest of mankind who have no hope. For we believe that Jesus died and rose again. And so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who are falling asleep in him. According to the Lord's word, we tell you that we who are still alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will certainly not precede those who are falling asleep. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so we'll be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. Amen.
Our second scripture reading. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 50 to 58. I declare to you, brothers and sisters, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Listen, I tell you a mystery. We will not all asleep, but we will all be changed. In a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. For the perishable must clothe itself with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality. When the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable and the mortal with immortality, then the saying that is written will come through. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to the Lord. He gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourself fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. Here ends our scripture reading. May God bless his word. Amen.
Okay, so we want to invite Hassan to take us through a song ministration.
Jesus, you're the God.
Thank you, Heart Song. We are about to take the biography and to be read by Dr. Joseph K. Nkwa.
Says the preacher, vanity of vanities, all is vanity. After all this toil, there he lies, the man who held my hands in 1964 to Anglican Experimental Primary School. There he lies. After all this struggle, all is vanities. Biography of Kwesi Senti Bafoboni, Aka Babo. Mr. Kwesi Senti Bafoboni, popularly known as Babo, was the second child of four sons and one daughter born to the late Nana Sewua Abra Sewua Nsan Atajman the Fourth, Omahene of Sehwibekwai traditional area, and the late Madam Elizabeth Eniwa Acha of the Asuna royal family of Sehwiyoso. Kwesi Senti was born on October 20th, 1950 in Sehwibekwai, in the western north region of Ghana, and 1070 in 2020. Senti began his early education at Sehwiyoso Roman Catholic School, after which he enrolled at Sehwiyoso Secondary School. Upon receiving his GCEO level, he taught in the same secondary school for a couple of years. He completed a sixth form education at Konongo Odumase Secondary School and passed his A-levels. He was accepted into the University of Cape Coast, where he graduated with honors and received a Bachelor of Arts in Education degree, B.A. Holmes, Ed in History. Senti met his future wife, Hilary Admambedu, who was also a student at the University of Cape Coast. After the university, they got married and traveled to the United States of America to continue their education. Senti obtained a Master of Arts degree in International Affairs from Ohio University at Athens, USA. He worked for several years in the United States of America and returned to Ghana with his family. Back in Ghana, Senti demonstrated his multimedia and creative talent when he directed and produced a couple of Ghanaian movies, including Nkrabia and Beyond Suspicion. In the mid-1990s, a group of associates set up a radio station, Network Broadcasting Company Limited. The station operated under the name Radio Gold on 90.5 frequency. Initially, Kwesi Senti was appointed general manager of the station, and in 2020, he became the managing director. Babo built Radio Gold into a powerhouse in the media landscape, and many well-known broadcast personalities passed through his hands. He was the brains behind immensely popular programs like Concorsa on Radio Gold. He joined the National Democratic Congress administration, and from 2009 to 2012, Senti became the senior political advisor to His Excellency John Dramani Mahama, then the Vice President of the Republic of Ghana. For the following 4 years, Senti served as a presidential staffer and senior advisor on political affairs to His Excellency, former President John Dramani Mahama. His work brought him into contact with many dignitaries and world leaders. When not in politics, Senti was a private businessman. He was a member of the Agape House New Testament Church at East Legon, Accra. Senti was ill for a short time, and we hoped for the best, but we lost him on Monday, February 1st. He survived by his wife Hilary and 3 children, Amenua, Chris Kwaku Ajiman, and Kwaku Amoa Pafuboni. Their son Kofi Ajiman predeceased him. He also leaves behind his 3 brothers by the late Madam Elizabeth Enua Archer, Professor John Jeff Bafuboni, and Van Percy Bafuboni, both of Pennsylvania, USA, and Douglas Ben Bafuboni of Aburi, Ghana. Senti was predeceased by his sister Amafa Bafuboni. He was one of the many children born to the late Nana Atajimai IV. The entire Bafuboni and Ajmed Badu families joined the widow, Hilary, and the children to mourn him. We all give thanks to the Almighty God for giving us these years to spend with Kwesi Senti as a husband, father, brother, uncle, in-law, mentor, teacher, business colleague, politicians, and friend to so many. Kwesi, may your soul rest in eternal peace. Fare thee well, Kwesi.
Thank you so much. We'll be heading to the tribute, but I want to acknowledge. Want to acknowledge some more dignitaries who are here with us. Honorable Dr. Efrie Akoto, current Minister of Agriculture for the Republic of Ghana, and his wife. Want to acknowledge Honorable Asiedu Nketiah, General Secretary and former General Secretary of the NDC. Honorable Okujeto Ablakwa, Mr. Kweku Bakun, and the representative for the former President, J. A. Kufuor. Thank you so much. If I've not mentioned your name properly, please forgive me. I'm mentioning them as I see them here. Thank you. We'll be going to the tributes, but before then, we want to play a special song for our father, uncle, brother, and friend, and it to be played by the technical team. Thank you.
Back to the
Continue by acknowledging some dignitaries here. Earlier on, I didn't pronounce the name, so I'll pronounce it better now. The name is Nana Ya Achimpim Jantua, General Secretary of the CPP. I want to also acknowledge Edu Echampon, Special Aide to His Excellency J.A. Kufuor, Honorable Kenneth Ajay, former Deputy Minister of Defense, Honorable Sherry Aite, former Minister of Fisheries and NDC National Vice Chair, and an Honorable, Honorable Collins Dauda, former Minister of Lands and Natural Resources. Sorry, you are most welcome. So we are going to take the tribute now. And the tribute will be read in this order. Tribute from the wife will be read by Nana Ikuya Ajimanbidu. Tribute from daughter, Miss Mariama Igala, former President, His Excellency John Dramani Mahama, and the eulogy by Theodore Lamte.
Good morning. Bibi and I were together for 45 years. We met in 1976 my first year at the University of Cape Coast, during the rush. This was the time when senior male students chased new female first year students. He was outgoing and gregarious. Like the strategist that he was, he sublimely and sometimes brazenly outwitted his competitors. One time, as I stood chatting with an interested party, a taxi screeched to a halt beside us. Young Babo leaps out, lifts me up, and plops me in the back seat, and has the driver speed us off. He practically swept me off my feet. From the beginning, I noticed that Bibi loved the limelight. For instance, he would wear high, clunky guarantee shoes. I guess this will only be known by the older ones amongst us. The guarantee shoes, which made a noisy racket down the cement corridor with every step he took on his way to my room in Kevas. You couldn't miss he was around. We got married after university and traveled to the US to do the same master's degree. We lived and worked in the US for some years and had our beautiful daughter, Ama Niwa, before we returned to Ghana. In Ghana, Bibi's brilliance and creativity established him publicly as an astute politician, as well as a media authority in his running of Radio Gold. In fact, he encouraged me to host two programs on Radio Gold because he felt my ideas were educational. In private life, Bibi reached out in kindness and generosity to family and friends. He was a pillar and caretaker of many members of his family. He was also a philanthropist and supported various people he met. Bibi loved life. He loved sports, TV shows, movies, and he got me interested in tennis and American football. He took the outcome of the matches personally. He would even lose his appetite and say, "Maya basa," when his teams lost. He also loved sunglasses, shopping, clothes, and hats. When shopping, he would try on different sunglasses and hats, pose, and ask how he looked. At a certain time, because he enjoyed theater and stage shows so much, Bibi decided to try his hand at stage performance as a hobby. He started with comedy, but I had to gently break it to him that his comedy was sort of not funny. So he chose to learn the hand and other tricks of illusionist performers, or what we sometimes call magic people, those who do magic for theater. And he tried his hand at such tricks, and we used to go and watch on stage. He was particularly intrigued by the fact that the hand could be faster than the eye. He actually took some classes, and we spent hours perusing, enjoying, and buying tricky paraphernalia that he would use in performances. Ama and I were his dedicated practicing audience. He even staged some shows at Ghanaian gatherings in Dallas, Texas. His favorite, though, was showing off for our visitors and especially young Ama and her friends. He would demonstrate his new skills of making objects appear and disappear in his hand and from around their ears, hair, and body. They would watch in delight and clap for encores. Bibi would be beside himself laughing at his unique, boisterous laughter as he bathed in the joy and happiness of the moment. On the other hand, Bibi was even more passionate about national issues, improvement in governance and international affairs. He was also an avid historian with a master's degree in international affairs. When we were in the US, his proficiency and deep knowledge in these areas placed him in a position to act as consultant to provide briefs to several company executives who were preparing to enter new and foreign regions. Bibi was keen to grow in his relationship with God. He loved to share testimonies of particular blessings of what God had done for him. We would have deep discussions about God and the Bible. Sometimes he would take my ideas and encourage me to teach, write, and to share them with others. He would insist, "Nana, this is what God wants you to do." I would try my best to do so with God's help. 45 years, so many decades. We enjoyed good times
and struggled through some rough times. Early in our marriage, we had the devastating loss of our young son, Kofi Adjiman, to sickle cell anemia. In recent years, we have both suffered serious illness, which kept us apart sometimes. Yet our deep bond remained. I miss the long-standing friendship we shared. I miss our daily conversations, video chats, and our favorite TV shows that sometimes made you teary. The other day, I found your handwritten itinerary of the world tour you wanted to take me on next year after the COVID. It made me realize how hard it is to comprehend never seeing you again. Yet I take consolation in the peace that our Lord Jesus Christ offers. Bibi, when you fell sick, I didn't think we would lose you. After all, 2 years ago in your hospital room in the US, I looked on as you were hooked to a sea of tubes with paddles ready on your chest in case they had to revive your heart. I listened nervously to the beeping monitors and watched with trepidation the numbers on your heart monitor, especially at night. But you pulled through. I felt you would pull through this as well, even when you told me you were tired. Besides, you always encouraged me not to say I'm tired and not to give up hope because of ill health that I had suffered for some time. God saw you getting tired when a cure was not to be. So he wrapped his arms around you and whispered, "Come unto me." You didn't deserve what you went through, and so he gave you rest. Bibi, give Kofi a tight hug for me, our sweet angel we lost too soon. And as you rest in the Lord, I know you are repeating your usual morning praise, which I would like to share with everyone here at this time, to the glory of God. May we please have the audio.
O God Almighty, our Holy Father in heaven, praise be to you for all your wonders, your faithfulness too in the assembly of the holy ones. You are the God who stopped the sun for Joshua. You are the God who closed the mouth of hungry lions for Daniel. You are the God who parted the Red Sea for the children of Israel. You are the God who is able to act with supernatural power in our lives. You are Jehovah Jireh, the Lord our provider. You are El Shaddai, the God who is more than enough. You are Jehovah Shalom. You are Jehovah Shammah. You are Adonai. You are Jehovah Rapha, the Lord our healer. The things that are impossible with men are possible with you. Who in the skies can compare with you, Lord? Who is like you among the heavenly beings? There is none mightier than you. In the council of the holy ones, God, you are greatly feared, and you are more awesome than all that surround you. Almighty God, you are merciful. You are kind. You are a God of love. You are the rock of ages. You are the living word. Age to age, you are the same. You are the first and the last. You lived yesterday, you live today, and you live forever. You are an awesome God indeed, and you are worthy of praise. You are a great God. I adore you, O Lord, and I enjoy worshiping you. You reign, and you are robed in majesty. Your throne was established long ago. You are from eternity. Your statues stand firm. Holiness adorns your house for endless days, O Lord. My mouth will speak in praise of you, Lord, forever and ever. And I am so grateful that we serve a mighty right now, God. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
I read the tributes from his daughter, Amainiwa Bafoboni. Daddy, I miss your voice, and especially how you would call me daughter. My heart is wrenched, my stomach is in knots. Sleepless nights and then dreaming of you when I sleep, only to wake up to the cruel and painful reality of never seeing you again. I loved your passion for living and admired how you successfully maneuvered life despite difficulties. Daddy and I loved real estate. We would drive around, look at nice houses, and choose the ones we thought had the best designs. He would always say, "Don't worry, daughter, One day I'll buy this for you and your mother. He always did his best to make me feel secure and safe. If I called him that I was worried about my job or my salary, he would just say, "You have food to eat. You have a roof over your head. Don't worry, we are blessed. Just hurry up and have your babies." He told me every time he saw me that I was beautiful, no matter how I looked. He always made me feel special. "Daddy, you were always generous to me and lovingly concerned about my future. You were also very generous and helpful to others. I will do my best to follow in your footsteps." Coming home was so hard. Usually, I would spot your hat in the arrival hall at the airport. You would be smiling and cautioning loudly, "Hey, hey, that's my daughter." And then you would hug me and make me feel safe and secure. It is unimaginable and so painful for me that you will not be around for me to talk, to share ideas and crack jokes with. Daddy, I love you. I miss you, Daddy. May God keep you safe till we meet again. Thank you.
At this point, we want to invite His Excellency, the former President, John Dramani Mahama, to come and read his tribute. Thank you.
Thank you very much, clergy mourners. Normally, I would have this tribute read on my behalf by somebody else, but out of respect for my comrade, I would read the tribute myself. The Good Book describes the relationships that exist between people as friends or as brothers in Proverbs 17:17. And he says, and I quote, "A friend loves at all times, and a brother is born for a time of adversity." These words from the Holy Scripture aptly capture the long-standing relationship that existed between Kwesi Senti Bafoboni, more popularly called Babo, and I. It also summarizes his unwavering dependability and loyalty as we navigated the rough waves of Ghana's political landscape together. Babo indeed was both a friend and a brother to me, just as he was to many others. He had an arresting sense of loyalty and duty, and nothing could faze him once he pledged his support and commitment to any goal or objective that he set himself. It was this inherent quality of focus and taste for excellence that made him not only a pioneer, but also one of the best managers in the broadcast media space, where he became nationally renowned. In 1995, a group of friends set up a radio station, Network Broadcasting Company Limited. The station operated under the name Radio Gold on 90.5 frequency. Kwesi Senti was appointed general manager of the station in that year. In 2000, he was redesignated the managing director, during which period he operated Radio Gold, TV Gold, and Muntier FM. It was under him that Radio Gold nurtured and raised many of Ghana's celebrated media icons and personalities. Babo paid his dues, and the history of the development of Ghana's media in the Fourth Republic cannot be recounted without reference to his solid contribution. Incidentally, it was also through Babo's work at Radio Gold, where he had proven himself as a capable managing director and administrator, that I had the opportunity to meet him for the first time. I had been appointed a young deputy minister of communications at the time. We developed a friendship which was further strengthened as we were both social democrats, shared the same ideology, and had a lot of interests in common. He was a devoted comrade who served the party and later the National Democratic Congress government with everything at his disposal, his resources, his expertise, and his passion. We grew quite close, and living not far from each other in East Legon at that time, our families got more acquainted with each other. His wife, Nana, whom I called Justice, because of a courtroom drama program in which she was the judge, made the greatest sandwiches I ever tasted. And any time I traveled, Babo would duly meet me at the airport or wherever with a box of sandwiches from Nana. Because of our relationship, it was not surprising that when Professor Atta Mills of blessed memory decided to make me his running mate, it was in Babo's house that the news was first broken to me by a delegation led by Mr. Ato Ahoy. Babo served as my senior advisor on political affairs when I was the vice president. Later, when I became president of the Republic, I appointed him as my senior presidential staffer, and he continued to serve as my special advisor on political affairs. We therefore worked closely in government together for the 8 years I served as vice president and subsequently as president. As was expected, he distinguished himself in all these roles he played. There was never a dull moment when you were in Babo's company. He regaled us with stories of Sehuyo Oso Secondary School, including when Otunfo Nana Osetutu, the second Asanteeni, was enrolled there as a student. He also regaled us with the many other escapades he and his young friends were involved in when he was more youthful in secondary school. As a man of many parts, Babo was also a great writer. He wrote a lot of articles, most of which centered on his social democratic ideals. Just as he was passionate in his convictions, he was also very quick to recant and apologize when he was in the wrong. Babo was human, and like all of us, had his shortcomings. Babo had a rabid fear of death and was not ashamed to disclose it to those of us who were his closest friends. He said to me one day, he said, "The imperfection of this world is that after all the knowledge, experience, and perfections that we attain as humans, like Albert Einstein, Amadeus Mozart, Muhammad Ali, it must all go to waste because a man must die." I have since his death, on a few occasions in my quiet moments, wonder how my brother and comrade confronted death in his final moments. My brother Babo was very careful about his health and was always quick to seek medical attention when he did not feel well. And so when he fell ill this time, I thought it was just one of the usual illnesses he would normally complain about. And I was therefore certain that he would bounce back as soon as possible. Unfortunately, that was not to be. On the morning of February 1st, 2021, I lost my friend and brother Babo. Our party has lost a dependable son. Our nation has lost a media icon. And his wife, Nana, and the children have lost a husband and a kind father. We shared a sweet relationship. And from my wife, Lodina, and I, we wish our brother and comrade Babu a peaceful rest. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, His Excellency, President John Dramani Mahama. It's time for the eulogy, and we'll call on Chidura Lamte to take us through.
I am about to eulogize Mr. Kwesi Saint Ibafo Boni, whom many of you call Babu. I call him Uncle Bibi. I also went to the University of Cape Coast, just as Auntie Hillary and Uncle Bibi. I am reading this eulogy on behalf of Prof. Jeff Bafoboni, older brother of Uncle Bibi, who we call Uncle Jeff. He's not here because of circumstances beyond him. I invite you to listen to his words as I read this. I'd like to start off by thanking President Mahama and his family, the NDC members in attendance, and you all for being here today. Your presence means a lot to the entire Bafoboni family. On Monday, February 1st, 2021, at about 10:30 a.m., we lost our brother, husband, father, uncle, and a friend, Kwesi Senti Bafoboni, affectionately known as Babu. Our minds are flooded with memories, and it's hard to find words to describe him. We are all heartbroken, but we are here today not only to mourn his passing, but to celebrate the life of my brother, Kwesi Senti Bafoboni. I am Professor Jeff Bafoboni, the older brother of Kwesi Senti. Senti's Christian name was Benjamin. He later added Clarus to his name, and throughout his elementary and secondary school years, he was known as Clarus Ben Bafoboni. His association with a friend who believed in the concept of African personality convinced him to change his name to Kwesi Senti Bafoboni. My brother and I were separated from each other when he was about 5 years old. I had gone to live with one of my uncles at Gwaso in the Brongahafo region. He knew he had an older brother, but had no idea how I looked like until I came back to Seshibekwa to inform our father that I had been admitted to Opokuwari Secondary School. He was in school when he heard that I was in town. When the teacher refused to let him out of the class, he jumped through the window, ran almost half a mile to the house, and on seeing me, started crying and asked me not to leave him again. That was my brother, very loving, caring, and very loyal to his family. In his secondary school years, he met and made friends with many people, including Mr. Kwesi Edu, COP retired, Yao Jima, Justice Alex B. Poku Echampon, and the Asante Hene Otumfuo Opokuwari II. In 1976, he met a female student at the University of Cape Coast, who later became his wife. I understand my brother was so fond of this lady that he was always in her company. And anytime his girlfriend, Hilary Nana Ajiman Bidu, visited him in his hall, his friend would shout, "Bafoboniyo, Bibio," which in short became Babo. That is how the nickname Babo originated. In 1978, after my brother completed his national service at the University of Cape Coast History Department, he was admitted to Ohio University at Athens, USA, to pursue a degree program in international affairs. Despite the graduate assistantship offered to him, my brother had a major problem, how to pay for his airfare. I offered to sell my electronic gadgets, but we were still short of money. Then he decided to randomly select a businessman in Ghana who he thought could help. The person he chose paid for his airfare and added some extra dollars. He did not know this businessman. In 1980, he decided to come back to Ghana to marry his fiancée, Hilary Nana Ajiman Bedu. And when he went to express his gratitude to this businessman, he was told the businessman had passed a few months earlier. He wept bitterly in front of the family, and all that he could do was to leave the gift he had brought from the USA with the businessman's family. Since then, my brother believed that random acts of kindness create a cripple effect with no end. And that's precisely why he was very sympathetic to people, his extended family, and everyone admired his kindness. In the early 1990s, my brother decided to settle permanently in Ghana after spending almost 15 years in the United States. It was a struggle at first. He went into movie production without any experience or knowledge in the acting or cinematography. He produced Ghanaian movies titled Inkrabia and Beyond Suspicion. In the mid-1990s, upon the recommendation of Mr. Atu Ahoy, who we all consider as our uncle, he was appointed a managing director of Radio Gold, a networking broadcasting company limited without, again, having any experience or knowledge in communications. His innovation skills and creative thinking enabled him to write scripts and create programs such as Inconconcern and Alaji Alaji that captured a large audience. And with the support of people like Kwame Safi Kaya and Fifi Banson, the station became one of the most popular stations in Ghana. His political career again began after Professor Atamills became the president of Ghana in 2008. He served as a senior advisor of political affairs to the then vice president, John Mahama, and later assumed the role of presidential staffer and senior advisor on political affairs to President Mahama. As an advisor, he traveled extensively with the president and became a very close friend to him and his family. After hearing of Sainte's demise, President Mahama wrote on his Facebook, "I have lost a friend, comrade, and a brother. Rest in peace, Kwesi Sainte Bafobani," into bracket, Babo. Babo was loved by many politicians in both major political parties, and he sincerely believed that winning shouldn't be a zero-sum game in politics. That was one of his concerns about politics in Africa. I know that many of you knew him for years and have found memories of him and his political life. His generosity of spirit and his continuous work in front of and behind the scenes for the party NDC. He loved fashion. According to him, fashion is about self-expression, and the type of clothes and clothing colors are a manifestation of one's personality. He always looked for trendy hats to match his clothes. When he walked into a room, he would light up with laughter. He had a good sense of humor and knew how to scratch hilarious jokes that made people burst out laughing. One of his jokes was about synonyms or words that have the same meanings but are used in different contexts. The words are conspiracy and plot. Plot is a piece of land. According to Babu, it happened that a school prefect in a secondary school who was responsible for seeing that first-year students maintained the plots allocated to them decided to use the synonym of plot to impress them. So during the general inspection of plots, the prefect confidently shouted, "All first-year students, stand up on your own conspiracy." Yes, he had a lot of these jokes, and you cannot help laughing when he made them. Watching soccer and playing table tennis, ping pong, were his two favorite hobbies. He was a diehard supporter of Chelsea in the British Premier League. He was always beaming with smiles when Chelsea won, but frustrated when they lost. I would call him from the United States anytime Chelsea lost, and his first reaction was, "Prof, I'm done with this team. The goalkeeper is no good." He had a passion for table tennis, even though he only had a basic table tennis skills. He was accurate in his techniques and executed powerful and precise shots to be able to dominate his older brother anytime we played together. The last video he sent me before he died was of him playing table tennis. The Bafobani family would dearly miss our precious Sainte, more than words can say. We should all be thankful for knowing you and your time on earth. We hope that everyone here today will take the time to think about all the fond memories they have of Babu. Our Sainte may be gone, but his memory will live on in us forever. Akwesi, as I used to call him, our lips cannot speak how the Bafobani family loved you. Our hearts cannot tell what to say, but God only knows how your siblings miss you. In our home today, it is lonely. One more thing, Akwesi. Take this message to our late parents, if you see them in spirit. Tell them we love them. Tell them you have joined them for a purpose. Tell them those they left behind are okay, because they left us with a legacy of unshakable faith in Christ, reasonable hope, and unbreakable family unity. Farewell, my brother. Farewell, my confidant. We are all comforted that you are with your Maker. So this pattern is well made. Amen.
In 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 6 to 8, the Word of God tells us what the Apostle Paul wrote as he faced his own death. "For I am already being poured out," the Bible says, "like a drink offering, and the time has come for my departure. I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith." Then he goes on to say this, "Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing." Consider how the Apostle Paul says that the time had come for his departure. Not too long ago, I was at Kotoka International Airport to pick up a friend, and I noticed two very different scenes in different places representing different perspectives. On the upper level, there was one scene. As I waited, I observed on the upper level, there were scenes of sorrow. There were scenes of sadness. There was a somber atmosphere as people were saying farewell to family and friends. Some people were in tears, knowing that they might not see their loved ones for a long time. You saw people embracing, but not the joyful embrace of someone welcoming someone home, but it was an embrace of parting. For the upper level is a place of goodbyes, of farewells, the place of departure. And the goodbye is tearful as the loved one goes for an undetermined amount of time. But on the lower level, the scene was quite different. The same airport, the same purpose of being there, and yet on the lower level, there was joy, exuberance. There were balloons and flowers. There were banners and children dressed smartly to welcome Daddy home. There were signs and tears of joy, kisses and hugs. Children ran to meet fathers and mothers. Husbands ran to meet wives and vice versa. Long-separated sisters couldn't stop laughing. It was a place of reunion. One location, but two very different perspectives. For those arriving, the airport is a scene of joy. For those departing, a scene of sorrow. And doesn't this describe for us death? For depending upon your perspective, it is a sorrowful event. It's a time of departure, a time of farewell. Death brings great sorrow, but to others, death is a homecoming because the departure signifies an arrival. The departure signifies an arrival into a joyful reunion with Jesus Christ and those we love. That's why Paul said in Philippians 1, 21 to 23, "For to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. If I am to go on living in the body, this will mean fruitful labor for me. Yet what shall I choose? I do not know. I'm torn between the two. I desire to depart and be with Christ, which is better by far." Listen again to verse 21. "For to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain." And then verse 23, "To depart is better." We don't often think of death as gain, and we certainly don't think of it as something better. But Paul understood that for the one who has Christ, the one who has hope, the one who has the eternal perspective, departure from this life is arrival in heaven. Departure from here is surely something better. How could he say that? How could Paul say death is better? Well, it's all a matter of perspective. You see, for the man who has lived with eternal values, departure is arrival in a great joyful place. It's leaving this earth to go to a place that is perfect, heading into eternity. For the man who set his sights on eternity, the culmination of his efforts and the great joy and reward of expectation is met. For the person who's learned to count his days and make his days count, there will be no regrets at the end of this life, only glory and honor and everlasting joy. For the fact is, those who believe in the Lord Jesus Christ leave this earth to gain something better. We leave this mortal body, which is perishable. We leave this mortal body, which is subject to sickness and pain and disease. We leave this temporary life with all its suffering and struggles, and we gain an eternal joy. We gain bodies that will never perish. We gain a reward that will never be taken from us. We gain a place where there is nothing but peace and joy and happiness. We don't often think of death as gain, but for the Christian, that's what it is. And it's all a matter of perspective. But the fact is, to the follower of Jesus Christ, we have to let that perspective influence the way we live now. My fondest memories of my father, Kwesi Sainty Bafobani, were of his joy, his encouragement, his generosity, his faith, his prayers, his discussions with me about the Bible and spiritual things. For he possessed that faith that has taken him from this life to someplace better. And even though his life here was successful, impactful, meaningful, prosperous, he has left behind something inferior to gain something better. For no matter who you are, no matter what you've attained or what you have achieved in this life cannot compare to the life to come, eternal life with Jesus Christ. Reminds me of the time when a Christian, an old man, Pakisi, lived in a village and he was full of faith. He was always praying and receiving revelations. And one day he got a revelation that deeply troubled and concerned him. For in the night he dreamed a dream, and in the dream God appeared to him and said, at midnight of the next day, the wealthiest man in the village will die. Well, Pakisi woke up and realized that he had to warn the wealthiest man in the village. He had to tell the wealthiest man in the village. So he went to see Joseph Mensah, the wealthiest man by far in the village. He knocked on the gate and they barely wanted to let him in, for Pakisi was just a pauper, an ordinary man, no one of stature or means. But he said he had an urgent message. And so they ushered him in and he passed through the protocol and was eventually seated in this large mansion owned by Mensah. Pakisi, when he met Mensah, began to tell him, last night I had a dream, and in the dream the Lord Jesus appeared to me and said that at midnight tonight the richest man in the village would die. Ha ha ha, Mensah shouted, you must be joking. You know I don't believe in God. You know I don't believe in that nonsense. There's nothing after this life. All we have to do is to gain what we can in this life and enjoy it, for there's nothing beyond this. I don't take your words as meaning anything. Pakisi pleaded with him and begged him, but Mensah wouldn't listen, and so they parted. At midnight that night, Mensah had stayed awake just to make sure, just to be sure that there was nothing that would come from what Pakisi had said. But the clock struck midnight and Mensah was still alive. I knew it was foolish. I knew it was rubbish, he said. He went to sleep and said, in the morning, I'll call Pakisi and tell him what a fool he's been. In the morning, Mensah woke up and called Pakisi, but to his surprise, the news came back. Oh, they found Pakisi dead this morning. He died at midnight, the richest man in the village. Not the one with the most money, not the one with the most fame, not the one with the most accomplishments or the biggest house or the nicest car, but the richest man was the one with faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. For he had left this life to gain eternal inheritance. That's what Jesus promises to all who believe in him. In John 11, 25 and 26, he says, I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, even though they leave behind this world, even though they may not have accomplished or accumulated things in this life, even though they die, they will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. For the good news is, when we give our lives to Christ and embrace him by faith, when we dedicate ourselves to him, we can have that confidence that this life is not all there is. This life is just a vapor, a passing, but we are being ushered into something better. Do you have that confidence? Do you have that faith today? If you departed earth today, would you arrive in heavenly shores? For the honest truth is, you can't fly Satan's airline and expect Jesus to pick you up at the airport. How we live now will determine how we arrive in eternity. And yet the good news for all of us is this promise from Jesus in John 3, 15 to 16. Everyone who believes in Jesus will have eternal life. For this is how God loved the world. He gave his one and only Son so that everyone who believes in him will not perish but have eternal life. God loves everyone. God calls everyone. Salvation is available for everyone, and for everyone this life will end, and for everyone there is a future awaiting us. For everyone who calls on the Lord will be saved. No matter who you are, no matter what you do, we can all come by faith in Christ and receive him. For the Bible makes this invitation to whoever will answer. In 1 John 5:11 to 12, the Bible says, God has given us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have God's Son does not have life. And all through the Bible, the word whoever calls us and beckons us to respond. The Bible says, whoever drinks the water that Jesus gives will never thirst again. Whoever lives by believing in Jesus will never die. Whoever believes in Jesus receives forgiveness of sins through his name. Whoever confesses that Jesus is the Son of God will be confessed by him in heaven. Whoever believes in Jesus will never be put to shame. Whoever believes in Jesus is born of God. Whoever desires, let him take the water of life freely. Over and over again, Jesus makes an invitation to whoever. And the chance is there for all of us on this sober and memorable occasion as we honor the life of our father, our brother, our uncle, our friend, Kwesi Sainti Bafobani. It's a sobering opportunity for us to remember that one day we too will depart. But even though our departure may be filled with sorrow, there is a deep and abiding joy that when we faith in Christ, our departure signifies an arrival. And whoever you are, whatever you've done, wherever you stand today in the presence of God, you can receive the promise of eternal life so that you know your departure is an arrival into eternal shores. If you simply believe, receive, and confess him by faith, Jesus Christ. I was blessed on Sunday, January 31st, to visit Bibi and to pray with him. As we prayed together, I sensed the presence of angels in the room. And I said to him, I sense angels in the room. When I left, I told my associate, I believe the angels are coming to bring healing to Bibi. The next day, I got the news that he had gone, and then I realized the angels weren't there to heal him. They were there to escort him home. Bibi had faith in Christ, put his hope in Christ, and today, he is in a better place, rejoicing. And if he could speak to us today, he would say this: whoever you are, believe in Jesus. Join me in a better place with a better future. Let your departure be an arrival to the presence of the Lord. Shall we pray? Almighty and everlasting Father, we thank you so much for your grace, your goodness, your love. You sacrificed all for us. Lord, we thank you that you've opened an invitation to every one of us, that this life is passing as a vapor. If we have 80, 90, 100 years, 120, it's still going to be gone in a moment, in a flash. It's over. Help us today to grasp the truth of the eternal reality that when we depart this life, we arrive somewhere else. Put within us faith today. Touch our hearts to call upon you. I pray for each and every one in this sanctuary today, Lord, that our hearts will turn to you, that your spirit will come upon us, and that you'll give us hunger to be with you in a better place. Give us your perspective, eternal perspective, that we might be reunited with you, with Bibi, and all those who've gone ahead of us. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. After the service today, if you would like to speak more with me or any of our pastors about the next stage of your journey at the end of this life, we would welcome your discussion. We also welcome you to come in fellowship with us where you can prepare for eternity by learning to follow Jesus Christ. This time I'd like to pray for the family of our late Kwesi Sainti Bafobani. Would the family kindly stand as I pray a prayer blessing over you? Would you join me in stretching forth your hands as a sign of your support and love for the family of our beloved father? Almighty and everlasting Father, we come before you now in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. We lift up the family of Kwesi Sainty Bafobani, and we ask, O God, that your Holy Spirit will come to bring comfort, strength, hope, and grace. Lord, dry their tears with the fondness of their memories. Dry their tears with the fondness of their love for him. Help us, O God, even in our sorrow, to look to you and to be restored, to look to you to have hope, to look to you to be filled with peace that comes from knowing Jesus Christ. We commit our ways and our family into your hands today, and we ask for your abundant blessing that you will protect them, guard them, keep them in all their ways. We pray for provision and for peace. We pray in the coming days that their hearts will turn towards you as you comfort them with the nearness and the closeness of your presence. We ask, O God, for your abundant blessing to sustain them throughout the rest of this day and in the days to come, that, Lord, in fondness of memory and in eternal gratitude to you for a life well lived, we will take solace, comfort, knowing that in Christ we will meet together once again. We bless all those who are here today in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen.
Brethren, it's time for the offering. We'll be taking two different offerings. You can see the offering boxes. There's one labeled family and one labeled the church. The one that goes to the family, the one that goes to the box labeled family will go to the widow, and the one labeled church will go to the church. Give and God will bless you. Give as a sign of love, a show of love to the family of our departed friend. God bless you. The ushers will lead you as her song also leads us in a song. Thank you.
Down on my team, hold me. Jehovah, He'll bring through this barren land. I am weak, but Thou art mighty. Hold me with Thy
Can we humbly bow down our heads as we pray? Father, we bless your holy name. We thank you for these offerings. These are tokens that we have brought before you in response and in obedience to your word. Bless these offerings. Increase them, O Lord. May they overflow. Even as we give this to the family, may it bring blessings. May it go a long way to console them. And those that have been given to the church, we pray that it will go a long way, O Lord, to draw many and to push the kingdom of God. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Before we continue, I want to acknowledge a few more dignitaries who are here with us. Mr. Michael Edu, NDC Western North Regional Chairman. Mr. Kakra Esamwa, NDC Director of Communication. Honorable Galus, former MP for Damongo, Mr. Kojobonsu, former mayor of Kumasi, Madam Obobia Dakon Opoku, Deputy Director of Communications, Professor Kwamina Ahoy, leading member of the NDC, Mrs. Charlotte Atu Ahoy, wife of Mr. Atu Ahoy. And then finally, Ms. Gloria Akufo, former Attorney General. Once again, you are all welcome. We'll take the vote of thanks from Isaac Japon. Isaac Japon will give us the vote of thanks. If he's here, he can mount the stage. Thank you.
I have the only responsibility to address the members in this congregation. Your Excellency, the former President of the Republic of Ghana, the Honorable Members of Parliament, former Ministers of State, current ministers of state, the clergy, Nananom, ladies and gentlemen. I am greatly honored by the Bafboni family to perform this singular role to render the vote of thanks on this solemn event. Let us raise our hearts and hands to praise and thank God for such a wonderful weather. We thank you, Heavenly Father. The transition of our beloved Kwesi Senti Bafboni has brought the Bafboni family face to face with very important personalities in our country, Ghana, and even beyond our borders. We thank you all for coming in your numbers to mourn with us under such an unusual atmosphere of the COVID-19 pandemic. Since February 1, 2021, when death laid its icy hand on our beloved Kwesi Sinti, the family had made several visits and consultations with Nananom from Sehubekwai, Sehuyoso, and Doma. The office of the former president, the NDC hierarchy, the clergy, and friendly individuals on how best we can find a fitting place of burial for our relatives. All your ideas and pieces of advice have been well received and put into action as you witness today. We are greatly indebted to you. The outpouring of sympathies, condolences, moral and material support have been very tremendous, for which we say thank you. Your Excellency, former President of the Republic of Ghana, please permit me to mention this. How proud we the Sehuis were to see one of us occupying the high office of advisor to the president. Sobremamo, Yawa, President John Dramani Mahama, Yadawase. We thank you very much for the support you have given to the widow and the entire family. To you, the event planners, Theo and your team, we say well done and thank you for carrying out the plans which emanated from Dr. Jeff Bafboni from USA. The 1 week celebration, the 40 days observance, and the wakekeeping were well attended under strict COVID-19 protocols. The working conditions between your team and the family were very cordial. We cannot forget the hard work of the Lashibi Funeral Home. As you all know, our brother, our beloved Sinti, his body is intact. The family did not have it easy at all, but under the capable hands of Justice Paul Bafboni, Osajefo Oseadeyo, Nana Dr. Ajimabedu II, and Nana Echia Kwame II, peace prevailed. The cooperation between the family, the widow, and the children was greatly needed. We thank our elders for their efforts. Brothers and sisters in Christ, please join me to thank the clergy, the leaders, and members of this great congregation for the service we have participated in today. The tributes have been far-reaching, touching on the life of our beloved relative. And who was this illustrious son whose life we are celebrating today? I know Dr. Jeff Bafboni would like me to say just a word about their beloved father, Nana Senwuabra, Senwuasan, Atajman IV. If Nana were here physically today, the chorus that will echo in the air will have been, "That's my son. That's my son." Meba no. Those who know the person I'm talking about will understand that that's how Nana Tajma used to talk. Nana loved and admired excellence. And you will agree with me that the celebration of Senti's life today has been excellent, even though mournful and sad. Soon, the curtain will be drawn to a close, and the coffin containing the earthly remains of our beloved Senti will be in the capable custody of Nana Akua Ajapoma, the Queen Mother of Ayim, of Ekona Royal Family of Seibekwai, and Nana Echia Kwame II, Kandanguru Bohene, and Asuna Royal Family of Sehuyoso. They will find him a private place of eternal rest. We thank you all for your participation and what we are going to donate. May God richly bless you. Thank you all.
Thank you so much for staying with us all this while. Before Hassan comes in, as we bring this program to a close, I want us to take this very few announcements. But before that, let me acknowledge the presence of Honorable Seth Abloso, former General Secretary of the PCP, if I'm correct. You are also welcome. Now, donation stations have been set up outside of the auditorium. That's Carl Bank has set up there. So if you want to donate, you can go there and donate. There's also a QR code at the back of the brochure, so you can donate through that if you so wish. There's going to be reception at the Enclave Gardens, just 5 minutes or 3 minutes drive from here when you are driving towards the tunnel. That'll be the reception. There'll be no reception in the house. So when we close, you all move there for a short reception. And there'll be no Thanksgiving service tomorrow. Thank you very much for participating. We welcome Hatsong.
Please want to take our last hymn, and we would ask everybody to be upstanding. Please stand up with us. Seek the land above.
steady course we steer, aspiring to the plains of light. Jerusalem,
song. This is the order in which we'll be moving. The pallbearers will lead with the casket, then Agape House clergy and all recognized clergy present, followed by immediate family, and then special guests and dignitaries, then chiefs will follow, and then the rest of us will follow. I take it again. The pallbearers will lead the delegation with the casket, followed by the clergy of Agape House New Testament Church and other recognized clergymen present with us. Then the clergymen will be followed by the immediate family. Then after the immediate family will be the special invited guests and dignitaries. This will be followed by the chiefs, the nananom among us, and then everyone else. We'll urge you to remain standing with all due respect as we file out. So once again, you are welcome. We are so happy you attended. This is Agape House New Testament Church. We are a Bible-believing Pentecostal church. And every weekend, we have 4 services here. On Saturday, we have 6 p.m. to 7:30 p.m. evening service. And then on Sunday, we have 3 services. The first service, the 7:30 service, followed by the 9:30 service, and then the 11:30 service. We have a special guest in our midst, all the way from the USA, who calls Ghana his home, Reverend Dr. Scott Camp. He'll be preaching this weekend. And I'll urge all of you, our church is open for all of us to come and worship. And I want you to know that all protocol, COVID protocols, are observed during Agape House services. Thank you very much. And then I want to invite and welcome the father of the house, Reverend Richard C. Whitcomb, for the closing benediction. Thank you.
Shall we pray? Almighty Father, we thank you for this ceremony which has brought honor and glory to your name and comfort to our hearts. We commit each and every one in our departure and ask for your blessing, your peace, your grace, and protection upon us as we go. Lord, throughout the final burial rites, we pray for your blessing and your presence to cover over all that is said and done, that your name will be glorified and our father, our brother, our uncle, our friend will be received into heavenly quarters and his body into rest in the ground. We thank you and we bless you for all that you've done for us. We praise you and give you the honor and the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Now receive the benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and grant you his peace in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. pallbearers will be followed by the clergy. The clergy will be followed by immediate family. An immediate family followed by special invited guests and dignitaries. And then the chiefs will follow. And after that, everyone can follow. We want to humbly ask that we keep standing. If you can stand, remain standing as we pay our last respects to our brother, our friend, our father, our uncle. Immediate family will follow the clergy. Immediate family. Immediate family will be followed by special guests and dignitaries. We urge everyone to keep standing as the chiefs follow the dignitaries. Chiefs can follow the dignitaries now. We want to urge all of us humbly to remain standing. Please remain standing, humbly remain standing until the chiefs file out. Thank you. Let's please remain standing until the chiefs file out. We humbly ask that we all remain standing with all due respect.
for family.